Today, I'm going to discuss the O1 model from OpenAI, which was reportedly codenamed Strawberry, and which is a month or so old at the time of writing. The short version is, it is nowhere near as good a coder as an experienced professional programmer, and any non-coder who blindly uses it to generate code for them to run in production is opening a can of worms. Well, a can of bugs. But the set of tasks that O1 can do is impressive, and it's becoming more and more difficult to find easily demonstrated examples of things it can't do. There's a ton of things it can't do, but a lot of them are so complicated they don't really fit in a video, so finding that sweet spot's difficult. Also, and more importantly, some of the expectations I had for how well O1 could or could not perform certain coding tasks were just wrong, and so were some of the ideas I had about how best to use it, for better and for worse. Moreover, as much as I hate to say it, and I really hate to say it, I think this is the first AI that codes well enough that there are a small number of specific kinds of entry-level developer jobs it could actually do as well, or maybe even better, as some new hires, at least until the new hire gets a few months of experience under their belts. More about that later. That has a lot of implications for the profession, and I'll talk about some more of those as we go. The good news, in my opinion, is that I think this is going to push the profession in directions that are long overdue. The bad news is, between now and then, the profession is likely to be messy as f- This is the Internet of Bugs. My name's Carl. I've been a computer professional for 35 years now, and I'm trying to make the internet a less buggy place. And boy, do I have my work cut out for me today. I did not expect that I'd be working on evaluating O1 for much of the last 3 weeks, but there's been a lot to unpack. I've got hours of screen recordings of my experiments with it that I still need to catalog, trim down just to the interesting stuff, annotate, and upload as evidence. Once I do that, I'll put links in the description and put a post on my community tab, so subscribe if you're interested in seeing that. Out of those will come some deep dive videos I'll put up for channel members. I'll mention some of those specifically as they come up today. This video is a summary of my findings and what I think they mean for the profession of programming. Now, caveat here, I'm only going to be discussing how O1 works with the kinds of things that programmers do for a living. I'm not worried about passing the bar exam or scoring on benchmarks or whether or not it could replace other kinds of workers. That's somebody else's problem, or at least a problem for a different video. In my last very brief video on my initial thoughts of O1, I ran it through the same build a simple HTTP server in Python challenge from CodeCrafters that I had used in a previous video to compare a bunch of AI editors. O1 pretty much aced that test, so I needed to try something more difficult. The good news is that CodeCrafters has a bunch of different challenges. I'll put an affiliate link below if you're interested in trying that out. I picked the build the grep command in Rust challenge to hit O1 with this time. Now, this is harder for an AI because there's a ton more Python code out there than Rust. So it's going to have a lot fewer Rust examples to draw from. As Rust goes, it's still pretty easy though. First off, this is basically just a string matching task, and that's one of the most common types of toy interview type problems. And there are lots and lots of examples of that out there on the internet. Secondly, for Rust, it's really easy. The complicated part of Rust is when you're having to make sure that you're only mutating state in a single place or having ownership in a single place so the borrow checker doesn't yell at you. And this task doesn't require that at all. I picked this challenge so that I could talk about regular expressions also, because regular expressions are a really useful thing for all programmers to learn. I had an exchange with someone in the comments of one of my videos the other day about regular expressions, so I know that some of you aren't comfortable with them. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail on regular expressions in this video, because a lot of you aren't going to care. But the deep dive code video I'm planning for channel members will talk about them a lot. What I will say now is that I use them probably every day, and they're one of the most valuable tools in my toolbox. I think that every programmer can benefit from knowing them. Regular expressions can be used to do a ton of stuff, but when people are introduced to RegExes, they often see crap like this particular one, which is used to match email addresses. Now that thing is a nightmare. That's the RegEx equivalent of minified JavaScript or an obfuscated C program. Don't do that, and don't let anybody check anything that looks like that into your code base. To learn regular expressions, learn them a little bit at a time, and then build up what you know over time. And that's exactly how this challenge is designed. Anyway, more about RegExes in the upcoming channel members deep dive video. As a control, I ran ChatGPT-4o through this grep RegEx challenge, and it just failed. I spend about 40 minutes, 45 minutes with RO. I let it make 20 or so attempts, including creating an infinite loop, which was a mess, generated a giant log file. And when I gave up on it, it still had 4 steps to go, which meant this was probably a good test for O1. And O1 cleared the whole challenge. It wasn't perfect, but it did an acceptable job. And I'm not gonna lie, that kind of bugged me. So in response, I made it worse. I decided I would really trip it up. So instead of feeding it one little step at a time, like the challenge is designed, I took all the prompts for the steps in the challenge and I put them all in one prompt file. I figured that the planning phase is where it would struggle, and boy, was I wrong. It did significantly better when given all the requirements in one prompt than it did piece by piece. It wasn't perfect, but it was so much better. In fact, I'd say that it did a better and much faster job writing Rust than I could have. Now, I've only ever played with Rust. I've never actually done a whole project with it. I'm not an expert at it, but I couldn't have done it nearly that fast. Now, I didn't really believe it. I thought it might have gotten lucky. So I created a new conversation, fed it the same combined prompt again, and it performed the same. A couple of minor syntax errors. Once it got through those, aced the challenge. And it didn't repeat itself. So there were 2 completely different implementations, but they both worked, at least for all the test cases in this challenge. As a sanity check, I went back to ChatGPT-4o and gave it the combined prompt, and it did significantly worse than it had when it got the requirements one at a time, which is what I expected. But O1 does not work that way at all. So then I ripped out all of the instructions from the Code Crafters challenge, and I replaced them in the prompt file with the regular expression section from the grep man page. I just went to the man page, I grabbed the bit about regular expressions, threw that in the prompt, handed all that to O1, and it handled that just as well. This O1 thing is different. It's not perfect, we'll get to the shortcomings in a bit, but it's very different, it acts very different. So I've been saying for months now that AI couldn't do the work of a programmer, and that's been true, and to a large extent it still is. But in one common case, that's less true than it used to be, if it's still true at all. So I've worked with a bunch of new hires that were fresh out of CS degrees from major colleges. So generally, these new hires come out of school unfamiliar with the specific frameworks used on active projects. They have to be closely supervised for a while before they can work on their own. They have to be given self-contained pieces of code so they don't screw up something else and create regressions. A lot of them have never actually built anything that wasn't in response to a homework assignment. And I think some of them have never written anything that wasn't designed to be printed out on a dead tree and graded. And some of them don't ever seem to have touched source control before. This O1 thing is more productive than most, if not all, of those fresh CS graduates I've worked with. Now, after a few months, the new grads get the hang of things, and from then on, for the most part, they become productive enough that I'd rather have them on a project than O1, if I had to pick between the two. But it takes a while for them to get to that point. Now, being perfectly honest, I think this is more a condemnation of the current computer science departments and corporate structures than it is a reflection of how great the AI is. Like I said in my video on how Agile caused the AI crisis for programmers, and my videos on how interviewing is broken, this industry has defined a lot of jobs in such a way that an AI can slot right in. I've always thought that it was dumb, and when I have a choice, I never hire anyone who only has an academic and theoretical understanding of programming and has never actually built anything that faces a customer, even if they only built it for themselves. But in the tech industry, many companies specifically create entry-level positions for new grads that know nothing about Git or pull requests or unit tests or continuous integration or fixing user-reported problems in a complex system, but who can answer leak code questions in interviews. Now, I'm pretty confident that O1 would do better at answering the vast majority of those leak code questions than the vast majority of the candidates. And it would do a better job of most tasks these developers are capable of doing their first few months. In my opinion, those positions where people can get hired with no practical experience, those positions were stupid to have before and they're completely irrelevant now. But as long as those kinds of positions still exist, and now that O1 exists, I can no longer honestly say that there aren't any jobs that an AI could do better than a human, at least as far as programming goes. So, what can't the AI do? In that same video from back in March about Agile paving the way for the AI hype, I said that soon AI would be able to grind through a lot of the backlog tasks that I hate doing. I don't think O1 is there yet, but it's heading in that direction. AIs are much worse at making incremental changes to existing code, and they're much worse at understanding existing big code bases. Unfortunately, that's a really hard thing to show you in a video. I can't just dump a huge code base in a prompt and like expect that you understand what it should be doing when it's supposed to be picking stuff out to handle bugs. So I'm not sure exactly how to demonstrate that, but it doesn't do a good job of that at all. For now, people are generally still better than O1 at figuring out where and how to make requested changes to a large, unfamiliar code base. But I'm not sure how much longer that's going to be true. So, a better question. What can't the AI do that an entry-level programmer can, at least if they're given the opportunity? So first off, an AI doesn't show initiative. And a new grad can, or at least they're capable of it once they get some real experience under their belt. Note, this is a double-edged sword at first because they blow it a lot early on. The initiative they show tends to take them in the wrong direction. That is why it's all the more important that new programmers should build real things. Not homework problems, but real user problems, to jumpstart that process of learning how to take initiative. This AI is also not any better at writing tests, which is interesting. I gave it the problem that was used in the Claude 3.5 demo that I did a video about, and it wrote the same kind of crap test where you ask it to check whether or not the function's correctly making a circle, and it just checks the four most extreme corners, and if those are good, it thinks the whole thing must be a circle, which is a stupid way to write that test. But it did it the same way that Claude did it, which was just idiotic. And it sucks at things that have changed recently and at judgment. I've talked about this before. I talked about this with the prime number sieve, among other things. So to illustrate this, I went back to Code Crafters and I picked a different challenge. Now this one was to write a very, very simple SQLite reader in the Zig language. So this only does a tiny, tiny fraction of what SQLite can do. So it doesn't do inserts or table creates or even joins. Just really simple raw reads of common data structures. O1 was utterly, utterly incapable of even writing Zig code that could compile at all. The Zig code it wrote seemed like it would have compiled, but it couldn't. Even when it tried over and over, it was consistently using Zig functions wrong. It seemed to be fixating on a Zig version 0.10 from roughly November of last year. When I asked it for a function definition, that's the version I got. Code Crafters was using a later version, so the old stuff that O1 was spitting out just wouldn't compile. When I asked O1 what syntax changes were made in a given Zig function and releases after 0.10, it would give me the right answer. So it knew that the changes had happened. When I gave it the compile error for the file, it would correctly say, oh, that must be a Zig version compatibility issue, and it would update the one line to the new version, leaving all of the other old usages in the entire file. Went through several rounds of this, fed it several errors. It never realized that if one function call needed to be updated to a version later than 0.10, all of the changed function calls needed to be updated to a later version than 0.10. And there have been a bunch of changes since 0.10. It's possible maybe that it would have gotten there eventually, but I ran out of my allocation for O1 runs. Now, I don't think I've ever worked with a programmer that couldn't have figured out really quickly once they figured out I need to use the new version, not the old version. I don't know any programmer that I've ever worked with that wouldn't be smart enough to go, okay, I need to do that for the rest of them too, at least after one or more compile errors. So like I said in my video with Proof News, AIs often don't have the judgment to know which alternative to use. It's got two alternatives. It's seen more examples in the 0.10 than in the 0.12 or 13. It just goes to the thing that it's more probably weighted. It doesn't have judgment to understand which of those it should use. So this is why, as far as I'm concerned, the claim that O1 has reached human-like reasoning is untrue, unjustified hype. So where does that leave us? So AI is bad at judgment, at testing, and at initiative. And those three things are generally not expected of, or often even allowed, of entry-level programmers at big tech companies. And O1 is better than pretty much any candidate at pretty much all of the questions that get asked in a LeetCode code interview. So the question is, if a senior developer plus this AI can get more work done for the next few months than a senior developer plus a few new grads, what's the point of the traditional new grad entry-level programmer job anymore? Now, before you panic, we've been here before. There have been many times that vital programming skills got obsoleted by tools. When I was getting out of school in the 1990s, the big skills were memory management, Hungarian notation, and the API differences between SunOS, Solaris, HPUX, and AIX. We got garbage collection, which meant we didn't have to worry about memory so much anymore most of the time. Hungarian notation was this thing where you would code at the beginning of every function or class what the parameter types were for that thing. Autocomplete made that completely irrelevant. And then when Linux came along, all of the vendors stopped having their own version of Unix, and we didn't have to worry about the difference between SunOS and Solaris and HPUX and AIX anymore. Not long after that in time, it was a big deal to know how to individually walk and manipulate the document object model objects of the web pages. That's, if you've heard of the DOM, that's what that stands for. And then jQuery happened. Recently, the mobile world has largely shed the need for Objective-C and Java in favor of Swift and Kotlin. This kind of thing happens all the time, but it's painful. The old rules stop applying, the secure path to employment is no longer secure, the accepted way that teams are organized no longer makes sense, and it takes a while to settle on the new rule. It also means that companies, usually the smaller ones, sometimes even the solo ones, that pivot to use the new technologies and to hire for the new skills, have a competitive advantage, at least for a while. At least the ones that correctly deduce the new rules. And the old big companies, you know, the ones that have started big moving the company to agile initiatives in the last couple of years, yeah, they'll start thinking about the new way in a decade or two, by which time all the rest of us have moved on. So what does that mean to you? I still haven't seen evidence that the judgment problem is going to get fixed. And I still haven't seen evidence that the LLMs are going to be able to negotiate requirements and handle the interpersonal communication parts of the job of being a software developer. So I think that artificial general intelligence and wholesale programmer replacement is still a long way off. So I still think there will be lots of jobs for lots of human programmers for the foreseeable future. But I think those jobs, especially the junior ones, are likely to be changing soon, at least somewhat. Here's one thing to think about though. Big companies have issues at times like this. They have a ton of calcified processes that don't adapt quickly to new tech like AI. Additionally, a lot of big companies don't use AI at all because they're too afraid that their precious code might leak. And if they do try AI, it's not going to help them nearly as well because big companies tend to have lots of internal proprietary libraries and processes and patterns that all projects are required to use, but that the AIs can't possibly have been trained on. So this is an opportunity for a new generation of small, nimble companies to get an advantage over the behemoths. Some of you will be able to be part of that. I've done that before. It's a ton of fun. It's risk too, and hard work, but a lot of fun. This is all the more reason that you ought to build and publish something yourself, even if you have to do it on your own. That will position you better for this new ecosystem. I did a video on that. I'll link it below, and there are more videos on that path coming. But most importantly, we've now reached the point where I think every programmer needs to know how to use these tools. I expect it will only be a matter of time before it becomes a job requirement for programmers. Right now, it's just OpenAI's ChatGPT-O1 preview model that works this way. But in the near future, I expect that all the other LLM vendors, even the open weight ones like Meta's Llama, will have their own equivalent of this chain of thought improvement that O1 has. And as I said back in my AI testing video back in April, I expect that automated testing is going to become a lot more important because the AIs make a lot of stupid mistakes in judgment that no human would ever make. And that's going to cause unprecedented volumes of more and weirder and harder to find bugs. And I certainly hope that people give testing the output from AIs the priority it deserves, because we have way too many bugs already, even without the volume of the code that AIs can spit out. But we'll see what happens. It's certainly going to be interesting. Until next time, thanks for watching. Let's be careful out there.